Hey, hi, there you are.
Good to see you. How are you doing?
Good. We're having a forum with mayor candidates right now about homelessness. Well, I know, but it's about how we work together.
Especially the Chronicle.
Yeah. Yeah, if you want a button, vote 1, 2, 3.
Oh, button.
Oh, well, wear it and spread the good word. We're having a free forum on homelessness and the mayor's campaign. Hey.
Hey. Hey, so welcome to the Demonstration Garden's first ever mayoral debate and poetry reading. Or we should say poetry reading and mayoral debate.
Are you in the right spot?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, yeah.
So,
we have three candidates, 3 out of 6, 50%. That's pretty good for an event like this on a Friday afternoon. I'm figuring the other candidates are out enjoying the sunshine in the park someplace, taking it easy, as opposed to these three hard-working candidates who are taking the Tenderloin seriously. Today I want to welcome everybody here to an event sponsored by Tenderloin Votes, because more votes, more power, and the Tenderloin matters. Tenderloin matters so much, we're having poetry and a discussion today about some of the things that are most important to us. So some of the things I'd like you to know are, one, we have a literature table over there that is being happily personed by our friend Lydia, and there's all kinds of literature about voting, 1, 2, 3 voting, which I think we'll talk about a little bit today. Also some of the initiatives that are on the ballot, some signs that say vote, if you want to put those up in your window to encourage your friends. All kinds of stuff that's over there. And then behind Lydia is a table with some food, so if you start to get hungry, go on over and have a bite to eat. There's all kinds of tasty stuff. And today we're going to have poetry, we're going to have some discussion of our topics, and Dr. Dream is also going to enthrall us. So, first I want to start with a chance for each of the candidates to introduce themselves. And what I'd like you to do as you introduce yourself is to tell us, one, what your relationship to poetry is, because we need to know kind of like what you're looking for in the poets today, and then also what you would say is probably your one most important characteristic or quality that you're bringing to the mayoral race and what you would do as the mayor. So we're just going to sort of run up and down the scales here, and we'll start with Reed.
So I'm here first. My relation to poetry is very interesting. I'm not a poet. I've done some musician work over my years. I really enjoy I'm a guitar player and keyboardist as well. I've been involved in a couple of bands. Music speaks to my soul very strongly. In terms of poetry, I'll give you a quick thing. About 2 days ago, this woman, Cheryl, and I'm completely blanking on her last name, wrote this just incredible poem about the state of San Francisco today, and it sort of stopped me in my tracks as I realized the power that a poem has to remind you of the beauty and the opportunity that San Francisco has today. And I think, especially as we've been going through this campaign, it's very easy to get caught up in all of the discussions and anger and frustration that we see in the city, but there's so much greatness and so much opportunity when you look around yourself in San Francisco. And so poetry brought that back out to me, so I was very happy about that. And your second question? What am I running on? So I look around myself, I look around me in San Francisco, and I see an incredible city, a rich city, a diverse city, a passionate city. It's been like this for as long as I've been around, and certainly a lot longer than that as well. And the opportunity in San Francisco is incredible, and we're watching the city grow in ways that are sort of unbelievable to a lot of the folks who live here, including myself. And so we've watched the economy explode. We've watched our city budget balloon from $6.5 billion to $9 billion. And that should be an exciting moment. There should be a lot of money helping to go into the city to create a lot of opportunity for everybody who lives there. And the problem is that we don't see that. We're not seeing that opportunity go to everybody in the city. We're seeing it very concentrated in specific areas, and we're not seeing the broad opportunity. And so the reason I got into this race was really to say, we should be taking advantage of this moment, this extremely incredible moment for San Francisco, to actually provide opportunity for everybody across the board throughout the city and really rise to be the world-class city that we know we are and help. And part of that is taking care of every single person who is in San Francisco today and creating new opportunity for all the great things that we should be doing. There you go.
Hello. I have a button for you. I have a button to add to your repertoire.
You must vote. Don't forget to vote.
Okay.
It's not Halloween. Vote.
All right.
Treat yourself to vote and not vote.
So my name is Amy Farrah Weiss, and I am a poet, and I am a singer-songwriter. And I actually wrote a song about Diane de Prima before. I knew much about her as a poet in San Francisco, but she does live in San Francisco. Did you know that? Diane de Prima lives in San Francisco. I wrote this song because she was somebody as a woman who was able to actually break into that old boys club of the beat poets. She was one of the few that was able to be present and at the table, Diane de Prima. So I actually wrote a song. I'll just sing you a little bit from it. Oh, Diane de Prima, how'd you make your way into the old boys' club? And however do you know when what you have to say is truly good enough? That's just a little snippet. And why did I get into this race? It was December of last year, believe it or not. I've been doing this almost a year now. And the two reasons that I decided my goals for entering were, number one, I wanted to revolutionize participatory democracy. I wanted to reignite people's imagination and awareness of what's possible by getting involved in the systems that govern us. It shouldn't be fuck the system, it should be shape the system. And I'm, like fourth or fifth, depending on what side of my family, generation immigrant, right? Like most of us, except unfortunately the African Americans, are not immigrants here by choice, oftentimes because of slavery, and the Ohlone were here before us. But, we are immigrants in this way. And so, when I think about how we have to work with people who are here in San Francisco and starting off, and also, who have this legacy of being here, that's what I'm fighting for. So I'm very focused on how we revolutionize participatory democracy and get people involved in co-creating solutions. And the second thing that I'm really interested in is not just critiquing Ed Lee's administration, but actually figuring out how do we do something that's collaborative and strategic moving forward? And I have a background in doing that kind of collaborative strategic planning work. And it's really up to us, because the onus is on us in a democracy, to figure out what are the solutions for us moving forward. And I got a little off track earlier. Let me just go back to say, I know I was talking about immigration for a reason, and it's because my great-grandparents' generation, they were here and they were just trying to survive the system, right? First-generation Americans are just trying to survive the system. And then, my parents' generation, they were successful in the system. And my parents both worked for unions. My dad is a Vietnam vet. And so their goal really was just make enough money to retire and send their kids to college, because we're the first generation to go to college. And then my generation, we've survived the system. My parents succeeded in the system because of the policies that were there for them. And then I get to help shape the system by having gone to college, learned critical thinking skills. And for me, it's not about upward mobility in terms of money, it's impact ability. So let's change that idea of what the American dream is and understand that it goes in different phases. You survive it, you try to succeed in it, and then you shape it so everyone can succeed. And I've come up with some strategic plans to help affordability crisis, to help us with the homelessness crisis, and to really integrate the spirit of St. Francis back into the policies of San Francisco.
Yes!
All right, juicy.
My name is Stuart Shuffman. I'm also running for mayor, like these wonderful people. I am a poet. I'm a published poet. I've been a professional writer for many years. I've got a little thing that kind of, I didn't think about this till right now, but I wrote something that passed around quite a bit on the internet. It's all about rent control, so I think you might as well read it right now.
Yeah.
It's called Rent Control in San Francisco is a Golden Handcuff. It's a hell of a thing to know that once you have to move, you can never come back again. And this is the last place you'll ever live in San Francisco, the city that you love and that you've given so much to. Having already chosen a life of semi-austerity, where you skip many modern comforts like washing machines and dishwashers, in exchange for the low rumble of Mission Street mornings. To live like you're a perpetual state of being a college student, in the sense that you reside among many generations of other people's stuff, mix-match spoons and cutlery, a revolving door of roommates and their things. Oftentimes, no one knows or remembers where these droplets of ephemera even came from. But now they are part of the house and essentially part of your life because you can never leave. Living in San Francisco and having rent control has become a sort of golden handcuff. If you ever need to move or get evicted, you have to essentially trade in your San Francisco citizenship. The Visigoths are at the gates and will gladly take your place, thinking that they've moved into something special without realizing they are pushing out the specialness like spin art. You are the drops of paint that make the color, but the faster things spin, all that's left are the streaks showing where you used to be. So that's kind of just about how, I mean, myself and most people I know who are creative who are still in the city, we're holding on by what we can because we are blessed to have rent control. The people who helped build the city to be what it is, who are smart enough to put some forethought into it and realize that to keep the city wonderful and to keep us in it, we need to say that the market isn't always right, and that people-first policies are important. And that's kind of what I'd like to take with what I'm trying to do with my campaign, is put out people-first policies that are saying people are more important than profits, whether that is having to do with rent control, whether that has to do with homelessness, whether that has to do with how we on corruption, and how we get microphones to work. It's all about how we treat each other, and this is one big community. And this is gold country. Money is always going to be made here, no matter what. It always has been, it always will be. But if the people are taught to make a little bit less, then we can take the rest of us and uplift ourselves with that money. And that's kind of what I'm pushing forward. I love San Francisco, and you're here right now in the middle of the day, so I know you love San Francisco.
Yeah.
And you love our community, and so do I, and I want to thank you for being here and giving us your time, and thank you for caring. And please vote for us.
Response to the shocking headline that says there is no punt. I think we have a little bit of a loose wire here, so I'm going to hold on to it. So I'm going to ask each of you to respond to that idea and tell voters about what they can do in response to that claim that there seems to be no contest.
Oh, my God.
So I think this time start with Amy and then go to Stuart and then come back. Does that work?
Yep.
People around the world are still fighting for that right. And it's really the only tool that we have in order to shape power in service to people and planet and equitable economy. There's this idea of the triple bottom line, and we, you know, because of alliteration, it rhymes people, planet, and profit. But sometimes we get stuck on that idea of profit because it really, we want equitable economy in which we're valuing people and planet and then working with that surplus to invest it back into the well-being of all. But those are the kind of things that could have been talked about in the media over the last 11 months. And I've been doing this for 11 months, and there was a point where I was trying to capture the imagination of the media a little bit more, and I came up with a survey where I framed the top 13 issues that I felt were facing San Francisco, and then I had an open-ended part where participants online got to say what their top three issues were without being influenced by my thoughts. And I crunched the numbers after I got about 250 people to take it or so. I crunched the numbers, put it into a one sheet, sent it out to all the other candidates, sent it out to all the media, sent it out to all the neighborhood groups. I had tried to also include all of those groups in the process. Wouldn't that be a great way to move forward? I'm kind of over the media now because it's just absurd that they're not covering this and putting... they're not using the power of the freedom of the press, which was also so hard won, and people don't have it in other places. In China, they don't have that. So we have to really fight to protect that here, and they're dwindling. They're just not allowing that power to be used in a way that could truly have lifted up this city over the last at least 6 months, where we could have been talking about the key issues facing San Francisco. And we have different analysis. Reed, Stewart, Francisco, even Kent Graham, those are the five of us that are challenging Ed Lee. We actually have put in analysis. We have networks of people who are experts in different subjects. And we have the ability to really, we have this chance to hold Ed Lee accountable and actually offer an alternative through democracy. And it was squandered. You know. But moving forward, I hope that you work with us moving forward no matter what happens on Tuesday. But we're going to win on Tuesday, right? 80,000 votes for the win. Yeah. But moving forward after Tuesday, let's go ahead and take what we learned from this. And I actually created a structure through my campaign, which is outline the top 12 issues, and then figure out what the key questions are, and all the candidates can work together, and the media can work together, and the neighborhood groups, and we come up with about 50 questions or something like that. We don't now. They have about 40 different neighborhood organizations that all have a different endorsement, or a Democratic club that has a different endorsement questionnaire, and you go and interview in front of all of them. And it wastes some time, because all of these groups can be working together to highlight what are these top issues, and then the public can actually see the different answers to the questions. And there's things like I Side With or Crowd Pack right now that helps you to figure out who sides with you as a candidate. And so if we were to all agree on that structure for a campaign, because we're going to have some supervisor elections coming up. So I want us to create a new structure for democracy in San Francisco. Are you with me? Are you with me? I mean, this is what we can do next time. Because this, I'm someone who I take different jobs and I work in different fields and I learn things so that I can teach them to people or improve those systems. So now I've gone through what it is to go through the elected democratic process as a candidate, and now I can help heal that and evolve that with everyone that's here. So I'm really excited about that. Media gets an F for this election cycle.
Yeah. Get me out.
Hello. All right, here we go. So I'm part of the media because I'm a writer for a number of publications, and my website, broadcaster.com, gets quite a bit of traffic. And so I've been lucky to get a little bit more media attention than some other candidates. But that doesn't mean that I give the media a pass on this, because something special is happening here right now. And I think, when the person we have candidates working together to try to take down the mayor, that really hasn't been done before. And I think that, I got into it with the editor-in-chief of Mother Jones. And I respect her a lot, and I respect Mother Jones a lot. They do wonderful investigative work. But I kind of was like, if Mother Jones isn't looking into this, what are the Mother Joneses of the world doing? Because I had issue with the words that she said, Ed Lee is running unopposed. And that, to me, did a disservice to the people the idea of what opposition can be. Like, I'm pretty realistic about my chances of winning. That Ed Lee's running unopposed. Opposition comes in the forms of not necessarily needing to win. Opposition can be, creating hope for people. It can be speaking power, speaking truth to power. It can be telling you cannot grind us down. Opposition is saying we are here and we're going to be here. You cannot get rid of us. This is our fucking city.
Right.
So there is opposition. And so I wrote an open letter to the media being like, you know, please, you know, this is what opposition can be, and we'd love it if you want to be part of this and help spread the word of what the possibilities are. And also, they don't know what this election is going to look like. If we get a sizable percentage of the vote, it's going to be they're going to have to change the way they look at elections forever, because the combination of grassroots organizing like this and social media, the people at the top don't know how to deal with that yet. They have no idea what's coming for them. And what it takes is, the people of power, their people are going to vote. But we need to make sure that our people vote, that you vote, that you get your friends to vote, and they get their friends to vote. They get out of bed. I know, sometimes it's hard to get out of bed. I'm tired too. But it's important that we can all do this together and show them that we are still here and we're not going anywhere.
Yeah! Treat yourself to a vote! Don't treat yourself to nothing!
Habitat for Humanity. All right. So we've already gone through a lot of what we've seen through the media. You know, I did an interview this week with a radio show called Here and Now. It's a national public radio show, and it's based out of Boston. And we were talking a little bit about the campaign with the host, and he was asking for some juicy tidbits about it. You know, and I told him a few, and then he turned off the microphone, and then I started telling him about a story with the Chronicle in San Francisco. And he was so in shock, he said, I got to set this all up again so we can get that story on tape. And the story goes, if you haven't heard it, that every year, or you know, every election cycle, the San Francisco Chronicle does endorsements. And they brought in, they normally bring in every candidate, they interview the candidates, and then they make a decision about who they're going to endorse. And this year they invited all of us, and a couple weeks earlier they actually invited the current mayor, Eddie, and they brought him in, and within a few days simply endorsed him. And this was a couple weeks before we had an opportunity to meet with him at all. And so this speaks to this sort of system of media and government that have been working together and keeping this firewall out so that we don't have any kind of opportunity. And they keep telling the same story over and over again, which is one essentially of power and money. And those of us who don't have enough money don't get any kind of airtime in the media. And so I think you've seen this play out throughout this election. And it just makes it very, very difficult to run in opposition to this. I think we need to have a city, we need to have a media that supports and encourages people and ideas and the right policies and the right directions is what we need to be seeing to help shape the future of San Francisco, not who has the most money or who has the most controversial things to say. So I think this is a really important piece of how we need to be evolving in San Francisco, and I just think, you know, really unhappy with even the FF Examiner, I think it was the Examiner that put this publication out. Same one, no contest. It's just, it really does a disservice to how we actually think about democracy. And I think they have this sort of narrative in their mind that the people who run against mainstream candidates are sort of this group of comedic people who don't have any intention of actually winning an election. And I think that couldn't be further from the truth for all of us up here. And I think it's just been very unfortunate to see that the media plays that same game that our current political system plays.
Because that's really where ideas come from. That's what generates new ideas in our society. And that's why the Tenderloin is so valuable. Because it allows, I came to the Tenderloin almost 20 years ago with, you know, one pair of shoes and a 4 day of, you know, a time to have it, okay? And it, because the Tenderloin allowed me a certain latitude and a certain freedom, I was able to be that and then become something more. That's why we need to embrace the Tenderloin. Anyway. So, Tenderloin Votes is about We're trying to reach those people that, you know, that have never held a vote. And we do all the things that people say we're not supposed to do in terms of youth voter turnout. We're trying to, because that's where the new power lies, you know, I believe. You know, we can you know, go over voter registration rolls and make phone calls and knock the doors. But it's those people who don't vote who are in despair. That's our secret weapon. If we can get those people out of their despair, then I think we wouldn't have a chance at this.
Talking to people, and there was a real excitement and momentum and enthusiasm about it. And there was a poll that was done a month before the race, and I wish those results had been made public, because if they had, then everyone would have seen that it was actually John Obelos, because they were saying that there wasn't any one person that was out in front against Ed Lee as an incumbent, kind of a similar story that we're being told. But the polls would have shown something different, perhaps. John Obelos was actually closing in, and that would have galvanized people to vote more. And that's why it is upsetting that they're saying it's no contest, because we're actually doing polls online. And, the alliance that was formed between three specific candidates with vote 1, 2, 3 to replace Ed Lee is me, Francisco Herrera, and Stewart. And I do appreciate Reed's presence. But, you know, starting in June, you know, I was doing this since December. I was seeing he was out on the streets getting the traction and connection, and it was really Francisco and Stewart and I, so that was why strategically we worked together and are saying, you know, in the order of your choice, vote 1, 2, 3. And we created a Facebook group called Vote 1, 2, 3 to Replace Ed Lee. In the last month and a half, it's grown to over 10,500 people. And if all eight of those people vote 1, 2, 3 in some order, then that's 80,000 people, and that's how much we need to win this race. It's amazing. It's pathetic that 80,000 votes can get your next mayor. But feel that power that we have, where if everybody here talks to 10 people and says, please vote, And it doesn't just end for us on November 3rd, no matter what happens. I know a lot of people got disillusioned with the Matt Gonzalez campaign because they put their hearts into that, and then afterwards it was going up like this, and then it just stopped. And so I want to continue forward no matter what happens. On my election night party, that's over at St. Cyprian's Church at Turk and Lion, we're going to be talking about how we need to come out on Thursday, November 5th, because they're talking about, you know, Ed Lee came up with this affordable housing bonus, density bonus plan, and this is like Karl Rove at its finest, because it sounds so good, doesn't it? An affordable housing density bonus. But when you find out what the details are, you realize that they really don't have to build even much more affordable housing than they are now in order to get two extra stories. And so we need to shape that as the people, no matter what happens on November 3rd. Because there's some interesting ideas in that bonus plan, but it's all about us shaping it. And so because we've grown, I've never been part of a movement that's grown in a month and a half to 10,500 people. I'm excited. Yeah. And so I want to carry forward with everyone that's here too. And we get to really be the leaders to talk about the issues of our time. And I want, you know, if I become mayor, I want Reed and Stewart and the people here and Francisco and even Kent Graham, you know, who's just a real side candidate here, but he says, I want to look at that budget because I think there's a lot of waste. And you know what? I agree with you, Ken. And if you really like to do accounting work and he wants to do it for free and get in there, let's do it. Everybody add their skill for the future of San Francisco. So that's the vote 1, 2, 3 to replace Ed Lee. We hope you'll join us on Facebook or take one of these buttons and pass them around. Just a few days left, everyone. People power.
We don't want those kinds of people in our town. You know who I mean. They drink in public, urinate in public, they cuss and fight, sexually harass people, threaten them and break things. They have no respect for others. They're full of anger and will lash out at a moment's notice, even when they've been friendly before. Yeah, you know who I mean. Oh, not all of them are bad. There are some nice ones mixed in. People who are respectful and obey the rules. But you can't tell which is which. You can't tell who you... If you are dealing with one of the bad ones until they do something bad. Yeah, you know who I mean. I'm talking about football fans. Win or lose, there is always drunkenness, anger, and more often than not, violence, destruction of property and of people. We don't want that kind in our town, but if we must have them, keep them quarantined to a small area so the rest of them can get on, the rest of us can get on with our lives. Okay. Instead of doing a second piece, I'm going to give a very short explanation of how the stadium racket works. So the stadiums are paid for by the taxpayers, and if you don't vote, they threaten to take their team to another town, which I don't really care about, but that's what they always do. Now, the stadiums are paid for by the taxpayers, but the owners of the team get money from the ticket sales, the concessions, the clothing, the naming rights, everything. So this is just another example.
Along with the housing affordability crisis and crunch and whatnot. So I put my mind to this starting in December of last year when I decided to run for mayor. And what I came up with, and I think David Peary was actually at an event where we were putting some of these pieces together back in December or January, talking about transitional eco-villages. And what's wonderful with this day and age of modern technology is you have access to so much data that's already been collected, and so we don't have to reinvent the wheel. There's a fellow named Nicholas de Monchaux. He's a Cal Berkeley professor, and he actually did a project a few years ago where he indexed all of the city's underutilized and blighted land parcels, and he found thousands of them all over the city. And so my idea is to take that index that we already have, and these are, you know, under overpasses or alleyways, and these are generally in places where there's a threat there because these places are blighted, and there are already places where people are living for a lot of them too. And so instead of saying, you know, we're going to push people out for the Super Bowl, and we're going to get rid of these tent villages that are there. Of course, they're saying, you know, put them through the navigation center now, but that can only house, I think, 75 people at a time, and only, you know, a few hundred people have been able to go through this. We have thousands of homeless on the street. We can't just look at one navigation center and say, hurrah, you know, but we actually came up with this idea for transitional eco-villages before the navigation center came around, and then we were thinking, oh, well, that's good. I'm glad that the city came up with one innovative idea to work with this, but we need to expand that and do more with it. So my thought is that, you know, Ed Lee unfortunately made the Super Bowl a catalyst for talking about these issues, but that's in a way a good thing because that's a goal. And so I'm calling it the St. Francis Super Bowl Homelessness Challenge. And so, you know, what I say is that, you know, homelessness is not a game, but we can all win if we take on the challenge. Because we have to include this in a framework that people can get excited about. People love challenges. They love sports. So how do we bring these things together and say, what can we do with $5 million by the time of the Super Bowl rolls around? And so with my estimation, we've priced out these structures that are $600 each that have the solar panel on the top, a locking door. They're for one person to live in. And they have, you know, electricity through the solar panel. And what we can do is say, and they cost $600, 2 hours to construct. I want to be able to work with people in the Bay Area to manufacture these things on a larger level, but now we could access them from somewhere else. We could get 2,000 of them for $1.2 million. So what if we could provide interim housing structures for 2,000 people by the Super Bowl? If I'm mayor, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
And then there's $5 million that I set as a goal here for our target. What is that, the price of one Super Bowl ad? Is it? Mm-hmm. And the NFL just did some project where a couple of their members and players went out and experienced what it was like to be homeless for a night. Good. Now you know, get those people, have them work with us for this challenge. And the rest of the $5 million, you know, a big portion of it's going to go to outdoor toileting and hygienic showering off-grid. And so we have some examples of that right now. But remember, we're the headquarters of Burning Man. That's what people prepare for all year. And not only that, they make beautiful light structures and beautiful... Well, we can all work together so that it's not just, oh, yeah, we had to take some money and house the homeless. We're actually saving money because the Coalition of Homelessness actually put out this amazing report where they showcased how we're spending X amount on DPW, cleaning up the streets and pushing people out. That's millions of dollars. We could be investing that into programs that are stopping that problem from the start. And so the other piece of that is going to be providing jobs to people who have training locally, 100% local hire, 100% local hire. And we're going to have training for people who have been through mental health training, maybe through CCSF or other, maybe through a certificate program or a graduate program and need internship hours. And then people who have permaculture training. And so we're going to actually create these spaces in a way that beautifies the whole space so that neighbors aren't going to be complaining about it. They're going to actually say, this is a benefit to our neighborhood. And guess what? If they complain about the fact that there's going to be some homeless people moving in, tough. I'm mayor, and there's a crisis. And we're going to take care of our people and watch. We're going to have outcomes that we evaluate. And if you don't think that this is a better thing for your community in 6 months, 3 months, what have you, we work with you, and we make it better. But you don't get to be a NIMBY and say, not in my backyard, to helping our most vulnerable neighbors.
So the homelessness count just came out, I think, last month, and it proved what a lot of us already knew, that 71% of the people on the streets were in San Francisco addresses before they were on the streets. So these are our neighbors, these are our people, these are San Franciscans. And it's important that we look after them, because the most important word there is that they are people. And it's so easy to forget that, I think, when people are busy in their lives and they're going in and look at people on the street as more of a nuisance than as a human being. And it's important, and I think that's what really, when Ed Lee said, you gotta go, Super Bowl, you know, like, it's not that Super Bowl's not even happening in San Francisco. We're just pre-gaming for a party 45 miles away. It's ridiculous. But... these are our neighbors, these are San Franciscans, and it's important that we look after them. So if this idea of they just have to go continues, I propose this, I'd like to do an action when they start trying to round our people up, that we all go out on the streets, and you say if you get rid of them, you have to get rid of all of us. And then we get out there and we say these are our neighbors, and you just can't sweep them under the rug. And I agree with my colleagues here saying as well, I think long term, we have to think of homelessness, and we have to think of San Francisco, and we have to think of what the future looks like. And we have one plot of land that is going to be developed majorly in the next 10 or 15 years, and that's Treasure Island. And that is a huge amount of land, and I think that with the development that goes along there, we need to mandate that they develop transitional housing, permanent housing, and navigation centers on Treasure Island. So that way, there's always going to be places for people to go who need a place to go. And it's not like we're putting them away. There's buses that go into the city every hour. We can make it every half hour. That way people can get the resources. And there will be resources out there too. But we need to plan smartly and plan equitably for everybody in San Francisco. And if they want to build high-rises out there and build rich people shit, they got to take care of other San Franciscans as well. So, thank you.
Yes, we want New Orleans! Look! New Orleans Nation! We got a new warrior for San Francisco. Thank you.
that they'd like us to know, especially if some of us are headed off to vote this afternoon for early voting. I do want to remind everybody, polling day is actually on Tuesday. You are welcome to go to your poll that day, but all this weekend, the City Hall is open for early voting from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., and on Monday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. I would encourage everyone who's here who has voted to walk one other person who has not voted to a poll or to City Hall and ask that person to do that with one other person as well. That's how we're going to get out the vote, is person by person, one at a time, because somebody cares enough to say, your voice matters. So let us be sure to take at least one other person with us. So who's going to walk with me to vote today? I've got three people. I'm winning it today. Who's going to take somebody to vote next week? All right. Excellent. All right, Reed, why don't you set us off, and then Amy, send us on our way to go and vote. And again, my apologies to those who did not have a chance to read today, but we will do more of these debates and poetry in the future because Tenderloin
Police Chief in place. And we get to work with all tribes and United Players to be able to infuse the spirit of the police department with Grace Lee Boggs and Africa Bambaataa, who is using creativity to get people, you know, away from some negative outcomes that they were getting involved in because of drugs or violence. And we have to create these pathways for people. We have the ability, you know, I have a background in harm reduction and in medical cannabis. There are people dying on the streets right now because they're using a certain type of heroin. We need to stop that, and we have the power as mayor to say we're going to go a harm reduction approach. And right now it's cheaper for people to get dangerous heroin than it is for them to get consistent medicine that's herbal, which is cannabis, doesn't have to be psychoactive. So we have the ability to work with people and figure out that harm reduction approach and get pathways to prosperity. If we're mayor, we get to actually decide upon the development of the future. And we do that in a way that's based off of sound accounting and strategy. And it's possible to do that, but we get to shape that power. And right now at City Hall, Ed Lee is an extension of Gavin Newsom, is an extension of Willie Brown. And they, unfortunately, decided to cater to the needs of these large corporations and investors and developers rather than staying true to the needs of people and planet. And so we need to take power from them by voting. And I want you to feel that very deeply and know that it's up to you to get 10 people, everybody here, get 10 people that you know to get out to vote this weekend. Just get people to do it because this is grassroots movement. I was at CCSF 2 days ago and yesterday for teaching, and it was so beautiful to me to be meeting young people who are majoring in criminal justice and nursing and animation and accounting. And I want these young people to be able to keep living in San Francisco and adding to our economy and our culture. So this is what we're fighting for over the next few days. Take it seriously. Act as if the future of San Francisco depends on you, because it actually does.
Thank you both, and thank you to Stuart as well. And I know Casey's standing outside the fence, but I want to give a big shout out to Casey. Thank you so much to the Demonstration Gardens for hosting us on very short notice and putting together a lovely place. It's just so beautiful here. And lastly, I want to say on Tuesday, Tenderloin Votes is looking to get out every last single registered voter in the neighborhood. So if you have some time on Tuesday and would like to volunteer for an hour, for 2 hours, for 12 hours, whatever it takes, let's get all of our neighbors who are registered to the polls this time. And after the 3rd, we will start registering the people who are not yet registered and tell them how important it is that we claim our voice. Thank you all for coming.
And I'll be walking down to City Hall in about 10 minutes.
I'll have a bunch of-